welcome to another forgotten Audible find, and we're going to feature a special presentation on Charlie Peacock's Lie Down in the Grass. As many have requested us to do more series on these, I think a lot of people are more interested in the earlier stuff in Charlie Peacock, but Charlie Peacock's album is very significant. It's over 20 years of age now. It's gone to 30 years now. But Lie Down in the Grass is significant for one reason. It introduced Charlie Peacock to the Christian music world as a solo artist. And what that has done, it got him in the doors of creating and producing some of the best Christian music artists that are out there. We know his influence behind people like Margaret Becker. We know people who have influenced him, like Jimmy A and Steve Griffith, Steve Griffith is predominantly behind Audio Adrenaline, one of the best Christian bands of all time. And right there with Vector, we have the heart-pounding drum Hall of Fame drummer, Aaron Smith, who was 77s up till late 90s. Then he joined Reg Muffin Band with Rich Mullins. And if you go into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, you can see his actual drumsticks that he used when he was playing for the Temptations. He's one of the best drummers of all time. And with that influence, and of course, Jimmy A, who is known to help Charlie rededicate his life to Christ, which is another significant person. So that influence, and then his influence of music coming together, you get some of the most influential part of the Christian music. I don't think Christian music would have been as mainstream if these guys didn't put their hands in it. And
you can talk about this album and that it's it wasn't, when Peacock made this album, it wasn't just another Christian album. Oh, we're going to throw it in the Christian album bin. It didn't do that. This album actually, for this album, he appeared on American Bandstand. He toured as an opening act for The Fix, Let's Active, General Public, Missing Persons, and the Red Hot Chili Peppers. So this album is, if things had gone different for Charlie, he wouldn't have just been another Christian artist that people say, well, you know, Christian artists aren't as good as secular artists. No, that's absolutely false, and you'll find out 9 out of 10 times that's so untrue. It usually goes the other way, because we had a lot of secular people come over to the other side, and you'll find a whole lot more famous secular Christian former secular Christian artists than you will former Christian artists in the secular movement.
Well, the thing is he's probably one of those that the secular industry probably kicked themselves for not finding in the 80s because of what his significance became in the Christian world. And I think it's a lot easier to work as a normal person in the Christian world than it is in the secular world, I'd say. If you want a wife and you want to grow up with kids, you'd rather be in the Nashville environment than the California environment in the first place. If you listen to a lot of Daniel Amos's song, you'll hear them talk about the struggles of being surrounded by every cult that comes out of nowhere. And it's probably a tough world to have a love for people. But when you get down to the Nashville world, it's a little bit easier to raise a family, and that's the reason why you get artists like Bon Jovi moving towards Nashville, and you're seeing Nashville just growing, because it's a little bit easier to raise a family in the Nashville scene, in the Franklin, Tennessee area, and places like that. And Nashville just grows and grows and grows and grows. And Charlie Peacock is one of those who had to take his California lifestyle to Nashville and really change the industry. Not that he wanted to, but he helped change this industry to be more professional. And really, like I said, it's... But I think the whole thing is, if he didn't go more of a marketing value, when you take Vector, when it came out, which was geared to the mainstream market, and you take 77s at the same time, the idea between these two groups that were touring, 77s and Vector, is they were designed for the secular market, but they were Christian influenced, meaning that they could be played at the, in the Christian market and the secular market as well, with Charlie Peacock arrives in an island later with his self-titled debut, which is years later after this album, which is about 3 years later. But U2 is the only one out of that marketing that makes it. And the one of the reasons, I think, is because of their European ties, which is more socially acceptable for a rock and roller and the Europeans to go to church. They can't see rock and rollers going to church over here. It wasn't that acceptable at the time.
Unless you're African-American.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that's the thing about it. Or in the country music, I mean, all the times you could get up there, Hank Williams in the bars would sing all his songs, and at the end, in with I Saw the Light. Mm-hmm. And that was socially acceptable. So it's to do with ethnic. I think it's to do with ethnic music in general. It's okay to talk about religion and things like that, but like I said, you get Mike Rowe, who's the blues side of it, you get Charlie Peacock, who's a jazz side of it, and you've got a great combination musically with this album. And I'll say this, this is what I kept on listening to the album over and over again, the significance. To me, the more significance of this album is the music. Three things you have to listen to before we go over track is, number one, lyrically, in my opinion, this is not a lyrically strong album. As much as I like Charlie Peacock, and he does some great lyric, and I think that will be later on in his career, like you get West Coast Diaries, or you get everything that's on your on my mind. Those albums, to me, are more personal. He's more personal about his faith, about his life, and honesty, and that's the things you need in a good artist. So this album is not like that. Then number two, you get a good music improvisation. Sometimes you have to do a lot of things when you're budgetly restrained, and they were budgetly restrained on this album so much they couldn't afford a drummer. And that was really tough, because at the time Aaron was playing for 77s, which is we get All Filed Down, which they were going into their secular rivalry at the time with Mercy Mercy Mercy, which is one of the best drum solos, I mean, introductions you could ever Hero of Your Life on the 77s All Filed Down album. So he's over there. He can't afford a drummer, so they have to resort to a lot of drum loops. There is some percussion in it. And the thing is, you can get percussion pretty cheap. And I think he arranged percussion himself, which is... But budgetly, they created a unique sound. So that's where people say this album is is very alternative, very new wave. But it wasn't to do that. It's just what they had to, could afford at the time. So that's number two thing you got to look for. And so with that comes out, you get this more fusion type album, which is really great. So musically, this is grade A progressive fusion.
It come in at the right time, yeah, because exactly. That's 82, 83, 84 were the new wave. That was when new wave right. was at its peak. And, you know, a new wave artist more likely to be acceptable, or people that had kind of an alternative feel, which, you know, to really pinpoint what new wave and alternative is a little like trying to find a needle in a haystack, because they're not really defined in such a way. You have to
call it new wave is kind of the second wave of alternative music, and then the third wave would be the 90s alternative. Mm-hmm.
When it actually just became known as
right. And new wave was to get away. And let's bottom line, what it was is punk music, rock, really hard rock music, was not marketable music. Mm-hmm. And so what alternative music is music to be different and at the same time to be marketable at the same time, because it's hard to, at the time, to make money off of the really extreme type of music. And it doesn't matter at this time. Now it is. It's harder. Now we're getting back to this synthetic rock now, or synthetic pop. So we're reliving those days. So doing a new wave and the new romantics and that kind of thing was more marketable, because you take like Duran Duran is a very creative band. Two things hurt them was, number one, they were good looking, so they had a new romantic look, and then number two, their followers were followers of pop when they were really trying to shoot for a more progressive sound, and eventually they pulled out of their pop thing, became more progressive and more preachy with their lyrics, and which again you'll see their album sales decline. Charlie Peacock is in the same format with these guys coming out with these new romantics and the new wave and all this kind of thing. But he wasn't trying to shoot for a new wave album. I think this was supposed to be a fusion progressive type album. And it really is. It connects, but because you've got the electronic involved, you get a new type of music. And because of budgetary reasons, this makes up. And then, of course, the third thing to look for is the talent of the other people that are involved. A circle of friends, right. I would say. Yeah. That's the third thing you need to look at. And I think goes back to Larry Norman and people like that.
Yeah, that's something very important, if you'll notice, in early Christian music or Christian contemporary or Christian right. rock music. For instance, I was thinking along the lines of the first solo album that Phil Keaggy did.
Yeah.
If you listen to that, it's a very stripped down album, a lot of acoustic guitars. But in my opinion, it's better than some of the albums that come right after it.
Right.
A lot of people will like the one that has Love Broke Through on it better, but I prefer that album because I just loved the way the man produced the sounds from the guitar right. to the point that he didn't need a whole lot. And that's what he's done here. He's just taken and used what he had, and I think even using some things that just to him he just liked.
Right. So
let's talk more about that.
Well, let's talk more. We're going to talk over the circle of friends first.
Okay.
Let's go over the talent that is on this album, and you start, because I want to hear your opinion on these artists that are involved in this album.
Okay. Well. I didn't really go through all the musicians, but I just had noticed that Mike Rowe plays guitar on this, which is, that's 77's guitarist.
And if you go to Human Condition is the guitar riff Mike Rowe uses. So mm-hmm. you can, and especially if you listen to Human Condition, it's probably the only song on the album that sounds like a Swirling Eddies track.
Yeah. Well,
or a Daniel Eddies track.
And this is what's
and
sad
it's a good
about,
track. It's really good.
That's what's sad about that song is that a lot of people don't realize you may have gotten this album, and if you got the A&M version of this album,
right.
Human Condition doesn't exist.
That is a sin.
Yeah, well, that's, and it's very sad. In my opinion, Human Condition is one of the better tracks on it.
Right.
Which, you know, there's some on here I'd much rather have done without than Human Condition. But it was really it was removed, and Watching Eternity was also removed, and they were replaced with two other tracks, Young at Heart and Love Doesn't Get Any Better. The only thing that you might find as a plus side to Young at Heart is that background vocals is created with Rod Stewart. So that's kind of a plus side if you like Rod Stewart's vocals. Yeah, like I said, yeah, that's one of the better tracks. So that was just really, that would be, to
Jimmy,
me, that would
Jimmy
be going
A
like,
Jimmy A is back on there. Griffith is on there on bass. So you, that, like I said, the only vector that is not on there is, of course, Aaron Smith, and which is a shame because I think it would have helped the album out a lot if he would have been on there.
Well, it would have technically been a Vector album, though.
Yeah, it technically would be a Vector album.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think the whole thing is the reason, well, because you got to take the reason why it wasn't Vector because you don't have Steve Griffith's a contribution to it. Because Steve, and you got to understand, Steve and Charlie are probably neck and neck as far as talent. And Aaron Smith, too, as well. I mean, well, yeah. They're talented in their field. Because,
yeah, I mean,
like you said,
Jimmy
you
A. And, right. I mean, they're all
I mean, Steve Griffith,
awesome.
I mean as what he's contributed to the production scene is just as important as what Charlie Peacock has. Because a lot of people don't know, because before Charlie started really getting his rethink out there, before getting his name on Margaret Becker and all these other artists, Steve Griffith was there first. And I believe if you look at those Island records, and yeah, Steve Griffith is in the background there somewhere. Okay, because he's the first producer, probably one of the first early Christian producers in the 80s, like Charlie Peacock. Because, like I said, you get Audio Adrenaline from Steve Griffith. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, his name is all over those Audio Adrenaline albums. Yeah. And so he's a bass player, and he's on this. Jimmy A, of course, is in this. And we feel about, the way I understand with Jimmy A, and is that he is the one that has led Charlie Peacock to rededicate his life to Christ. He knew all this stuff at the beginning. And what we get into the 84 at this time, because 81 is a Charlie Peacock band. And this is so amazing, because this guy is not that old, okay? He's not that old of a guy. But already by 81, he's talented enough to produce his own album, get it out there. It doesn't get any play, but he doesn't get that much play. He's playing like $50 gigs. He gets into alcoholism in between 81 and, say, 82. And from there on, he gets a gig with Jimmy A. And Jimmy A comes up to him and says, you know, I'm assuming this is Jimmy A. Don't quote me on this, but this is what this article is leading to, where we get the Jimmy A and Charlie Peacock collection, that he comes up to Charlie and says, Charlie, God's told me that I should pray for you. And Charlie has admitted that he has problems, and he's gone to AA and places like that. And he just preaches the gospel to Charlie, and Charlie is just accepting what he's been taught as a child, and he realizes these things are true, and just needed Jimmy A to reaffirm those things in his life. And that's where you get, from there on, is Vector. And Vector becomes, I mean, it's a significant approach to the alternative and second wave of Christian music that needed to be, where the 77s and they're performing at the Roxy and places like that. And 77s was a band, they were probably the first, they were the Christian versions of the Cramps and artists like that. They were just very talented, and Mike Rowe was a very underrated person. And I think with Charlie Peacock's help, you know, 77s becomes where they're at. They have such a masterful production that Charlie Peacock is involved, that it's up to secular play. And like I said, at this time, this puts them into the ranks of artists like U2. U2 hasn't blown up yet, but they, people are saying, Rolling Stones is saying, this group, U2, 77s, they're just as good. They're great bands. You need to keep up, because these guys are the ones going to blow up. And U2, of course, blows up. 77 doesn't really blow up that well, but there you have it. So you got these circle of friends that Charlie Peacock brings to this album that are just amazing. And musically, this is one of the better albums in Christian music. And we'll go over track by track now on this album. And let's start off with side one. We've got Lie Down in the Grass. Whoa. Lie Down in the Grass. Whoa. This is the most catchy tune on the entire album. And you can listen to this song over. Even today, I think, even before I picked the album up again, you know, that song just, voice in the daytime, dream at night, on the street door, in the moonlight.
Lie down.
Lie down.
Lie down.
So you got this catchy riff in this song and catchy tune of the, and it's probably a very marketable song at well, and it just my feeling I've always felt with this song, here's what I give about Lie Down in the Grass over a lot of Christian songs at the time is we've always wanted to sing about grace and the feeling about grace, and I think Lie Down in the Grass to me is, of course, I think he said he wanted to give it a more shepherd feel, like David, you know, who was a shepherd in grass. But that's what I feel Lie Down in the Grass is about grace. And that's what I think it's the best and most significant song talking about that.
Yeah, it's, well, when I went back and looked at the 500 best CCM albums of all time, this one's number 10, which it's going from 500 down.
Yeah.
So it's the 10th best album. But I went back and read the review. I'd read some of the reviews on some of these beforehand. But the writer, he talked about how this album to him was based, or with this song here, was based on Psalms 23, which you have, maketh me lie down in green pastures, which is such a, you know, that's it, you know, because when I think of the song anyways, I just think of the literal application is just lying on your back and looking up and admiring the creation. But it, you know, taking it from the Psalms 23 point of view or perspective, you get the connection, like he said, with the shepherd. You do get grace from that, and you do get the ability to take your time out from whatever's bothering you, the cares of the world, to lie down in those green pastures and concentrate on the Creator instead of concentrating on your problems and concentrating on the situations of life. It's like you said, very catchy. I've heard it several times since having heard this album, so I can't say it's one of those ones that when I looked at the track I immediately knew the tune, because I did know the tune very well. But there's a couple on here, I'll get to them in a few minutes and talk about how those songs have never left my consciousness, because they are quite a few songs on here will be ingrained in your memory.
Well, and I'm not going to criticize the album, because it's, if you hear me later, you'll know it's not my favorite Charlie Peacock album, and it's not one of my favorite Christian albums. And a lot of people say, well, why are you doing this? Because it's a significant album, because it introduced Charlie Peacock to the Christian world, obviously. That's the importance of the album. If you take, of course, technically, you'd say, well, what about Vector? Well, Vector, well, not many people know about Vector. Not many people can tell you about 77s either. We found about these groups like 20 years or 10 years later. Okay, but Charlie Peacock's name, it doesn't matter. Yeah, by 87, you knew who Charlie Peacock was.
Well, he was producing everything.
Right.
I mean, he had his hand in composing. Well, I mean...
We never heard anything by him, but by 87 or 88, we knew who the guy was.
If you want one good example of how much of an influence he is, one of DC Talk's hits was his song originally,
right,
In the Light. And if you don't know that, well, you need to go back and check your liner notes.
And Love Life is probably a better album than this.
And that's where he got it, where he got budget.
He didn't have to budget limits. But because you go into, I'm just going to go over the tracks that to me stick out. And then I'll get him into talking more about it. Because Human Condition sticks out, of course, because Billy Rock guitar of Mike Rowe sticks out. And being familiar with maybe... people like Jimmy A or Terry Taylor and people like that. This is one of those songs that they could have done, The Human Condition, because it's that kind of thing. So it sticks out to me. And I don't know why some releases doesn't have this song on there, but it's a good track. And, of course, you know, talking about what it talks about, another good track is 1, 2, 3, That's Okay, where it's more danceable type tune than most of the songs on here. But probably the second to Lie Down in the Grass is going to be A Whole Lot Different and A Whole Lot the Same. That one really sticks out to me. And even though I don't think lyrically he put out the point, but he didn't have to, because you figured out what he was talking about with the song, because the music, this is where the music and the message comes together. I think the biggest problem with me with this album, because there's so much fusion of, and let me explain what makes progressive fusion. I'll say progressive jazz, or which is just fusion. So when I say fusion, I'm talking about progressive jazz. Regular jazz, or basically R&B music, flows into chords, and you can pretty much figure out where the next chord's going to go. You can't do that on this album, okay? If you think you're going to get in there and you whistle the tune and you know where the tune, because you know your major scales, right? So most people, we're going to go up here and we're going to go down here. It doesn't flow like that with the people. There is fusion in this album, and when I mean fusion, I mean the tune is going to go a different way. It's going to surprise you. You're going to have a trumpet that is going to go a different, it's still in the same major scale that it needs to be, but it's not just going to flow with you. You're going to think, oh, it's going to go up, it's going to go mid-range a little bit. He's a good musician, so you can't predict it. That's what progressive jazz is, or what I call fusion. It's a mixture of rock, really, rock and jazz is what they call it. But it's really good. So listening to this album, if you're a progressive musician, you appreciate that. A musician will take this album and appreciate what they've done with this, because they've done a beautiful album. So back to what we're talking about, A Whole Lot Different and A Whole Lot the Same is the second track off this album that sticks out, because it is lyrically correct and it is musically done to fit the message, and they come together, because you feel the love and understanding from Charlie Peacock's voice. You feel the love and understanding from the music, and it's really the attitude we as people, or we as Christians, need to take with others that are searching for the truth. And that is what A Whole Lot Different and A Whole Lot the Same does, because it gets you already at the beginning of the music going where Charlie Peacock is going with this, because we're a whole lot different. It's kind of like 77's A Different Kind of Light, but I think this is a better track than A Different Kind of Light, because I think also too, like I said, you have a love and understanding, and it's where we have to be, being surrounded by a lot of people who, like I said, the California mind, as Ojo Taylor calls it, You know, the California attitude gets the better of me. Must be something in the air. And like I said, with them, every time in California, were they around during the Jesus movement, it seemed like another cult was coming up here, there, and whatever. They addressed all those issues because they dealt with those people on a daily basis. Because you think, oh man, he's into Jesus, I'm into Jesus. And then you find out he's also into some bald-headed guy named Kudo or something, you know. Jesus and Kudo are one and the same, you know, or, you know, Harry Kidd, or, you know. And so this is that song talks about, and he even talks a little bit about the cultic sign. But then again, my lyrically problem I have with it is kind of like, I will never deals in the cards of tarot. And he's talking about, you know, the cultic side of it. And you like, you take Larry Norman's The Hexagram song and things like that. You think about those songs, but he's bringing out to the strange point that, you know, he gives you props for searching, but you just don't stop there. And I think that's the beauty of it. See, that's my biggest problem is people go out there and they say, well, you're being so closed-minded. And you're like, no, we've gone beyond where you've gone. And that's where I think we got to look at is you just don't stop. You go on and you look more into it, and you grow and you grow and you grow and you grow. Whether you lose friends or not, you're going to lose friends over different beliefs and things. That's just part of life. And because God is not about us getting together. It's all about him, because if he wants to, he can raise the rocks and the grass to call out to glorify him. He don't need us. But the point is, he wants you to enjoy the same enjoyment that he has, because we're made in his image. See, he's experienced all that joy. And for you to experience that joy, you just don't stop. You don't sit there and say, okay, I found Jesus. Now that's it. No, he wants you to go on further and get to know him more intimately. As could say, beyond that thing. It's like, I think the best reference I've ever heard is you take Yoda from Star Wars or The Empire Strikes Back, and Mark Hamill or Luke Skywalker ask, you know, he said, I'm looking for a great warrior. And what does Yoda say? He said, how does wars make one great? Now, what we then, but if you go back to the prequels, what do you see Yoda as being? He's a warrior. And because he's fighting the Clone Wars. But by this time, when Luke has found him, Yoda has advanced so much in his spirituality in the Force that he don't need to do those things to make himself great anymore. You see, he's matured. And that's the same way with our life, is we've got to go beyond just the smaller picture and into the bigger picture. And that's what a whole lot different and a whole lot the same means to me. And it's probably one of the most powerful songs I had ever listened to in Christian music. And it plays a very impact in my life every day, because I understand it when I'm dealing with people in disagreement.
I'm going to go back for a few minutes and talk a little bit more about that first track, Lie Down on the Grass. Not too much, but this album, I mean, this song in particular, not only has significance and being a great song and all that sort of thing, but I think it also kind of shows where Peacock would go later in his music, because it's got a tribal feel to it.
Right. Well, it's like I compared it to Burns.
Yeah, I talked about, well, Burns and another one would be Peter Gabriel. Peter Gabriel. Both and Byrne both eventually experimented with tribal music, and so, you know, I was trying to think, there was a group that he actually worked with, and they you know, and I can't remember their name. I got these words that jumble up in my head. And
he's worked with so many, it's hard to keep up with.
Yeah,
his,
but he,
credentials.
But I mean, that's the whole thing. That track, he, you know, he showed, I think, part of the type of love of music that he had, and the range. I mean, it's, you know, and that song, you know, it goes from, yeah, there's a trumpet in it to, you know, this tribal thing, lie down, and it's just, you know, it's got such a range of variation of uses of music, like which would be a jazz. That's a jazz thing right there.
Yeah.
But anyhow, like I said, well, like we were talking about during the new wave music, though, there was during the movement, there was that whole combination of things, and people were just really trying to do different things to market music to a new audience and do something a little different. And it's the first time I think that progressive music actually came out into the pop world, because since then everything's kind of gone back to what everybody knows. Oh, well, I know this works, so I'm going to do that. Whereas new wave, and people might pick any topic and sing about it. Nowadays, I mean, you can probably list on your finger the type of topics that people will sing about and actually get a pop hit. Whereas that is the perfect time for this album. Like I said before, there was two different releases of this, and I'm going to talk about the songs that were removed when it was made an A&M release. And they're Watching Eternity, which that's a tragic song to be removed.
And that's a good song.
But the reason that Watching Eternity and Human Condition were removed, this is a shocker, guys, if you've ever heard these songs, they weren't considered marketable. And I'm sitting here going, that's kind of like saying, I don't know, Beat It's not marketable. You know, Billie Jean is not marketable. These songs, you know, we know in the secular world are so catchy and so ingrained into our memory of those people that have heard the songs that how could they not have been? And that's the same thing with these songs. I can't imagine them not being. However, they are not songs, though, that I saw the titles and instantly the song came to me. There are two songs on here other than Lie Down in the Grass that do that for me. And when I was going over the track list, there's two songs. One is It's Gone, It's Over. Instantly, the chorus came to mind.
Right.
And I hadn't heard this album in years. And the other one is, Biff already talked about, was Whole Lot Different, Whole Lot the Same. And, I mean, both of these have such a catchy, and these songs clearly are marketable. And, you know, and it's just, I mean, I guess
well,
it's
the
just...
Well, the thing is, with the Whole Lot Different, Whole Lot the Same, though, it's marketed in the Christian world, but I don't think it would do very well in the secular world.
Well, if you take these A&M releases, if you looked at the lyrics on those, they're not very marketable either in the secular world.
Well,
but
I mean,
that's
a lot different
point
the world,
of the
yeah.
new wave movement, though.
Right.
Anything for the first time really went lyrically.
Yeah.
I mean, there were a lot of people that talked about spirituality in the secular world. If you go back through, and you'll find when you look at these people's background, well, that's why they were talking so much about spirituality. Because they were spiritual people. They either were Christians or some sort of religious person. You know, you get a lot of people that just really were able to just really express what they really believed and what they really thought about things. Or they might just talk about something that, you can't imagine somebody talking about that. But they did. I mean, Gary Numan made a hit off of a song about cars. You know, and it wasn't about how fast they were. It was just cars in general. But there you go. And this song might have a more deeper meaning. But, you know, it's to most people, it's just a song about cars. But getting back to that. Okay, yeah, Lie Down in the Grass and then Watching Eternity. Like I said, that was a tragedy, in my opinion, to have been removed from the A&M release. There's some that I wouldn't mind. Then It's Gone, It's Over, like I said, again, very, very ingrained in my mind. Human Condition, I have to agree, a very good song. Again, tragic that it was removed from the A&M release. One that I might consider would be Lost in Translation. That one I didn't really connect with. There's a couple of them on here I just really didn't connect real well with.
Right. It's not. It's like, to me, it's not one of the best albums in Christian music.
No.
Because, but it is a significant.
Well, it's not an album that'll collect dust.
Right.
I mean,
here's the thing about it is just, musically, later in your life, you're going to enjoy it more because you progressed musically.
Right.
I think that's the thing about it is for three chord rock and roll, this is not three chord rock and roll. And at the same time, when you're listening to The Cars or you're listening to other mainstream music out there that was big in those days, you put in something like this, this is going to take you by surprise. And the only thing that I can compare is, like, you know, maybe like the Talking Heads. We're talking about the Talking Heads or even groups like the Televisions or something like that. These groups that were just unique and had, you know, were different. And the thing is, too, is later on we see more of this guy come out because one guy said his vocals have compared to Smokey Robinson, R&B artist. And that was very... Oh, I'll tell you someone. He helped produce an Al Green album. I thought that was unique. I was surprised about that, which is one of his... obviously, he's got to have a little influence there. And maybe that's my the reason why you get ETW doing Let's Stay Together, which was a very, you know, and a lot of people get upset about rap music. But that's one of the better, they've taken a good song and have actually made it good using rap music. And I think Al Green was very complimented by that. Buy that.
You know, I'm not a big rap fan, but as far as it goes, if I had to list my favorite Christian rappers, ETW would definitely be they were just a very
so
good...
That was another idea what Charlie Peacock group. Was what he ended up doing, because secular music obviously took notice. I think like we said, the Island record, Charlie Peacock's self-title, probably might not have been because of this album. If this album didn't come out, I think they said, well, there's somebody here. And then you get the Island Records self-titled release, which is, to me, probably some of the better tracks, because you get Message Boy. Oh, who doesn't like Message Boy? that's a good album. That's a good song.
Yeah.
And so, which is one of my favorite Charlie Peacock tracks. And that's where that's where, like, oh, man, he's in your face now. Because you get that more, oh, wait a minute. This is what Carmen and Steve Camp is doing. And and I think he'd go, oh, I can do that too. And which, you know, and don't get me a step. This is one of the reasons why I struggle with the 500 best, because they don't recognize sometimes Camp and Carmen's contribution to the Christian world, because they're not musicians or per se, like the, you know, Michael W. Smith and Charlie Peacock is. But I love Charlie Peacock and what he does, and with this, and as far as me as a person, as I get older, something like this becomes more and more valuable and more in touch to your life. A lot of people struggle with Charlie Peacock and his openness about how he feels about men and women and the sexuality compared to spirituality. And I have to be in agreement with Charlie Peacock. And that's the reason why I don't want to get into another thing. I think promoting heterosexuality through spirituality is a far better way of projecting of God's way of sex. Okay, that's the way you portray it. And whether or not Charlie Peacock, on his agreement about sexuality, but you listen to his music, it's all about man and woman and God. It's good. And I think a lot of that, he gets that from Al Hurt, probably.
Taking that, you know, we're not going to go really far into that, but that album that he's talking about, referring to, Love Life, I mean,
it's about love and life.
Yeah, it's a very, it too could be considered a very significant album, because
but he connects love with spirituality, and when I listen, I say, I have to be in agreement, because if you don't have that spirituality, like God wants it to be, between man and woman, that's what you miss out on. Mm-hmm. in the man and woman relationship, you get the spirituality to it.
Right.
And someone who, if you're involved with a woman or if you're married, Rob knows what I'm talking about. I mean, Rob Lee knows what I'm talking about because he's married and he understands that. And where else is God going to express his love? Because he goes through about, oh, it's like Christ gave his love for the church the same way the man does. Wait a minute, are you talking? Yeah, that's where a reason why I made man and woman. You're like, oh, there's a bigger picture. Oh, you're trying to express love, true love.
Yeah,
see, we were just thinking that it was just, no, there's a bigger picture.
Yeah, it's well, that's the whole thing, and it's almost become, you know, the sad part about it is almost become a small piece of what love actually is has become more important, and like you said, people that just take that small portion of love and run with it and think, oh, this is the greatest thing in the world, they miss the next step.
No.
And the next step is even better because it ensures more of a lasting effect.
Well, you also find that God works in threes, basically. Even though, you know, the agape four loves, there's three main ones that are intimate of those four, which is the parental, the friendship, and obviously the love between the man and woman. Granted, we're talking, those three are the most intimate part, and they're more like the triune, you know, basically of it. So we've talked about the album then? We're talking about, we got more tracks.
Well, I just want to talk about the AMM releases real quick here.
All right.
Like I said before, for some reason, AM did not release, did not think that Watching Eternity and Human Condition were marketable, so they chose two other songs by Charlie Peacock called Young at Heart and Love Doesn't Get Any Better. I don't know, I haven't really looked into getting this on CD, but if I do, I hope that there's a deluxe edition with these two tracks on here, because these tracks are very good. They're not just stuff that, they're also not just songs that you immediately say, well, that's just about love between a man and a woman, no big deal, it's another love song.
Yeah.
No, these songs, even though A&M chose these songs over two other songs with spiritual mentality to it, these songs as well have a spiritual mentality to them. And, you know, like I said, I haven't really looked, but I hope if they did re-release this as a CD, that those two songs are also included, because I think you'll enjoy them as well. You know, it's just, it's, as we say, it's a significant album. Not the best album that he would ever do. But then, you know, that's great.
Right.
Because if you start out and, you know, hey, this has got some good stuff to it, hey, that's wonderful. But if you improve to that, or if you start out and that's the best thing you ever did, where can you go from there? And I don't think that Charlie was ever going to be like that. And I don't think he continues to do things. I mean, he's still making albums.
Right.
He's also involved in movies. I'll give you a good...
He was involved in music of the TV show Fame.
Yeah.
For about, I don't know, one episode or two. I don't know. But basically, the thing is, in comparison to the 80s, needed Charlie Peacock.
Yeah.
Because if we didn't have... we had Michael O'Martin already. And I think he set it up.
Well, there's others.
They've mentioned Brown Bannister and Brent Bourgeois and people like that.
Even Chris Christian,
people like that. Those set us up. But Michael Martin, I think, comes in there, and I think he kind of brings in that talent that we needed in the Christian music. And then Charlie Peacock comes down there as well. And what Michael Martin does, and lyrically to any artist is, instead of just being this way and this way and this way and being this way, he says, instead of just presenting it, you know, in a negative light, why don't you try this? And I think what it does, because at first I was totally against what he was doing until I started making videos. I didn't understand what Michael Martin was talking about. When he went up to Steve Gavin, Steve Gavin, I'm going to do this song about adultery. I'm going to just tell them divorcees up and get them all riled up. And he said, well, hold up. You know, I understand how you feel. You just got married and you think love, your wife's the best thing in the world. But hold up. You love your wife, right? Yeah, I love my wife. Why don't you write a song about loving your wife? Well, why would I do that? Well, because you're promoting something that's the opposite of adultery, right? Yeah. Okay. So what does he do? He comes up with two love songs.
Yeah.
And people, at first, I'm like thinking, oh, no, you tell the truth and don't matter what. But you know what? He's still telling the truth.
Yeah.
And at the same time, condemning a sin that is a sin, but instead of promoting something that's good. So, in other words, it's like Mike Warnke used to say, if you do the goods, you don't have time to do the bads.
Yeah.
So if you're out there loving your wife, guess what you're not doing? You're not committing adultery. Yeah, right. So I was like, I couldn't figure that out until I started making videos. And I think, because I remember when I was dealing with a very controversial subject, and I thought, I'm going to go after this controversy, but how in the world could I do it? And so what I did is I offered an alternative, and the subject became really alive. Or in other words, start out condemning your own people and then slowly getting into others as well, because you can do that as well. See, the whole thing, that's where you get the importance of Michael Martin. I think the importance of what Charlie Peacock does. Yeah. Is, you know, when he gets songs about loving your wife.
Well, when you,
you're
going to
forget about that
love,
adultery part.
A song that I don't know how it escaped secular airplay, because it's a very sensual song written by Charlie Peacock. It's called Love You Like a Woman.
Yeah.
And I don't even recommend single people to even listen to this song, because you really need, it really takes, and I'm not saying it's explicit per se, but it can be considered explicit. But at the same time, it's not dirty.
Yeah.
It's just talking about how a person needs to love. And I think the lyric in there that always stuck in my mind, and I love it to this day, because every time I hear someone writing a love song, and in my opinion, and this is my opinion, guys, if you write a love song and you take it to the point of it not really being about true love, I think it's a bit blasphemous.
Right.
Because we consider God to be love, then if you're sitting here and just making love some kind of casual thing, you're not really doing justice to love at all. And he has this lyric in the song, Love You Like a Woman, that goes, I heard this
cat on the radio
talking about the lovely name of love, but he didn't know a thing at all
about
so
love.
He was a liar
and a thief,
and you send him on his way.
Yeah.
In other words, you listen to these people that try to tell you that love is this casual thing or this feeling or you can't help it. They're liars, because love is deeper. Love is, like I said, it's not this little small thing. It's much bigger than that, and it can go on and on and on, and it goes on into eternity. And at some point when this whole existence is over, we'll see the full effect of that love and its eternal effect on humanity. And right now we just get little glimpses, and people just run with this little piece of it, and they just, oh, this is love and I feel it, and oh, and this is da da da, but they don't get that there's another step. They don't go to the next step. And you know, and they're to some people, I'm sure they even get to another step on that. But, and then, like I said, then it'll eventually, to some point, go into an eternal thing. Because, you know, it's wrapped up in God. Because God said that He is love, and those people that don't believe that, they don't understand love. All they understand is feelings and desires, and it's more on the line of lust and more on the line of things that just they're so base. They're so common.
And this is interesting because you know, I called him up about doing this album, and in between talking about Charlie Peacock, Prince has died. Prince Rogers has died, who we known as the formerly artist known as Prince. And when I told Robert years ago, I said, no other artist in Christian music comes close to Prince and Charlie Peacock when it comes to getting that sound down. And it's the truth, because if you listen to tracks like He Wore a Big Man's Hat, mm-hmm. and if you listen to... what he's talking about, that track that he was just talking about.
Love You Like a Woman.
Love You Like a Woman. Those songs are so close to what Prince did with his funk music that he did. And Charlie Peacock is one of those that could conquer that sound like Prince.
There's another one off of that album, too.
In fact, since you know, Prince has passed away, I encourage people to go and look up the album Love Life. Mm-hmm. And other songs like that before his Everything That On His Mind, and then his jazz band that he's in now for about 10 years. I encourage you to look up those tracks, because it gives you an idea of how talented this man is. And now that he's on a trip of what he's doing now, which I think is great, and he's a big, significant part of Nashville, speaking at the colleges and things like that. And so... is any more we want to talk about this album, or we're through with this? We got this, what we need to talk about? Because we appreciate you guys. Keep on putting the comments down. I'm getting a lot of requests. I think a lot of you are more interested in the foreign groups like Sima Ja and Garth Hewitt, and I see that. And the problem is we're kind of uneducated on a lot of that.
Well, I tell you what I'm starting to do, and I don't know if this might be something that – put this in the comments and tell me if this is something you're interested in. I'm starting to do some research on the British rock and roll gospel groups. There's quite a few that were very significant. Their stuff might be hard to get. I mean, you can find their things on YouTube, but to get an album, you might have to pay a little bit. But – and in my opinion, too, they're not really considered Christian contemporary. They're more gospel. And I'll real quick tell you the differences. Is gospel is more what we use to purvey a message to the secular world that they need a savior. When you're talking about Christian music, it can be that. But oftentimes Christian music is more for the believers themselves, to help them be encouraged. I mean, when I was a young man and I didn't have a whole lot of friends, Christian music was very important to me because I saw people that were like me. And they understood that having a relationship with Jesus Christ was not just about going to church and living a good life and all that sort of stuff. It was a whole lot more, because it was a lifestyle. And you changed your whole life to fit your relationship to Christ. And whatever he wanted you to do, that's what you wanted to do. Even if you found it physically hard or physically impossible, you still wanted to do whatever it was that he... And these artists, that's what the Christian music, the CCM, the Christian Contemporary Movement. But if you're interested in some of those, this is... forgotten Audible Finds, so we could do some of that too. I've got a couple that I would love to talk a little bit about. I may not be able
also
to get full
too,
albums, but
I'm planning on getting probably May 1st, where I'm changing formats from I don't know what we're going to do for how many channels. Some of our channels got to be cut out because there's just too many and we're too spread out. So I got a guy while we were shooting here, another guy who works on another channel, he just called me up to see when we're going to shoot again. He wants to set up a shoot for next week. And I'm doing a podcast as well. I've cut back on that. So what I'm trying to do is hold off till about May. But what I want to do with this show is it'll have its own Facebook page. So we're going to set up a Facebook page, and Rob and I are going to be administrators so that he can post albums on there and I can post albums as well, because that's probably better than doing a blog for this channel, which is good. Maybe eventually, if the views keep on going up, because the SEMA job video and the other video is going up as well, so eventually this show may branch off into its own channel. So you guys keep on watching, leave the comments on this, and I appreciate you guys requesting more videos, because this is the reason why we're here. So thanks guys for watching.